Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship service for Sovereign Grace Community Church for October 13th. Welcome to all everybody and also our visitors this morning. And we welcome those of you watching by 1 week delayed stream. And so our call to worship is from Psalm 96. So you'll stand and join with me and read our call to worship. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring in an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his name.
Great is the Lord, he is faithful. see he proves his love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory.
Let us pray together. Lord, we're thankful for this day of worship, for this time to meet together as your people to give praise to the greatness of who you are. You are our Lord and Savior, our deliverer, our salvation, and we praise you for this. We come before you with great joyful hearts, for we know that we've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And we come before you with great reverence, for we know that you are a holy God. And it is our desire, in fact, you have created us to worship you. And so we come this morning with our hearts lifted before you, praising you for your gracious goodness, for your kindness and your mercy and your love. And we pray, O Lord, that as we meet here together, that you, through the power of the Holy Spirit, would bind our hearts together and to help us to be aware that as we worship you, as we draw near to you, you are here with us. Prepare to receive the offering of your children as a sweet aroma of praise. And we do this to the glory of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Amen. And we can be seated.
Yeah.
Scripture reading from the letter of Paul to the saints in Rome, Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Since we have been declared righteous by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have also obtained access through him by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also rejoice in our afflictions, because we know that affliction produces endurance, endurance produces proven character, and proven character produces hope. This hope will not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. For while we were still helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For rarely will someone die for a just person, though for a good person perhaps someone might even dare to die. But God proves his own love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Hallelujah. How much more then, since we have now been declared righteous by his blood, will we be saved through him from wrath? For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, then how much more, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life? And not only that, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received this reconciliation. Amen.
That is certainly a great and foundational truth that we have for us as well. Well, good morning, everyone. We're glad you're here today. Glad you can worship the Lord on a little bit of a cloudy day. But again, the sunshine of Jesus Christ shines bright. And so we rejoice in that as well. We welcome our visitors and glad that everybody could be here today that are visiting with us, our special guests, and glad that you could make it to be a part of our service. So we have a very special family guest, a friend of ours. Betty is worshiping with us today, and our families go back, I think, more than 40 years, I believe. They are the ones who make me feel my age. I had the privilege of officiating at the wedding of her and her husband, and this week, I will be officiating the wedding of her son and new daughter-in-law. So I don't know if I'll do grandkids or not, but at least we'll try the ones, at least the next generation. So that'll be on Thursday. Please keep that in our prayers as well. We welcome you to our worship service. And those watching via the live stream, we are grateful that you're able to be with us and worship with us, and looking forward to the time when it can actually be a live stream rather than a tape delayed for that. So a couple of announcements we do need to be aware of, and I want to just point them out to you, that first of all, next Sunday, we will have our official kickoff Sunday for Operation Christmas Child. We have now, for the last few years, at least 5 years, have been there, the repository or the place, the repository of all the ones from Southern Sonoma County. And I know that there's a number that go through through Harvest Christian School here. And so next Sunday, we will have presentations, and maybe have some boxes so you just start taking home and start working on and start packing the boxes. And that will, the actual pickup will be in the middle of November, but the kickoff day is next week. So please be aware of that also. And then also, we had an anniversary last week. On Thursday, the church turned 14 years old. And we are so grateful to the Lord for seeing us through 14 years. We were at times wondering how long it was going to be and how much God was going to grace us with. And we continue on by his mercy and his grace to preach, proclaim, and grow each other in Christ, and to invite others to come be a part of us. So we had a celebration, and so we want to pray for our church as it goes into its 15th year of ministry faithful to the Lord. And then down below on this, on your information sheet, there is information about the hurricane aid. As you know, this past week, another hurricane, Hurricane Milton, came through almost the same place, or very close to the same place where the previous one had. And so I know there's great needs, and I know that the Samaritan's Purse is there, the Southern Baptist Relief is there. So these are two of them. You may have others you contribute to help out. These are two that we believe in because they're bringing the message of Christ as well as being able to help. And all the funds go to the relief fund. So you can find all that information. And as the Lord leads you, you want to be able to contribute to helping these people out in a very difficult time that they are going through right now. And then also one other thing I'd like to ask for your prayer support, and that is we have new sheets, financial sheets for the month of September. We're going to start every month being able to make that available to the congregation so you can see what is going on, and certainly we do need to make this a matter of our prayer. There was a shortfall of this for this month of September, and so we do need to seek the Lord for his graciousness and his provision as he has provided for 14 years, that we know that God will continue to do that. But there's information out there on the information table next to the Grace to You books that I'm sure you're getting a chance to look at and read. Take one home a week, look at it, include it in your library, or hand it to somebody else, or bring it back. Those are available. All that on the table is available free of charge. So we are grateful for what God is doing in ministry here, and thankful for his great grace in all that is being accomplished. This morning, we want to take a moment to pray. We pray quietly at first, and then I lead us in prayer. A couple of concerns we want to pray for. I did not get a report for the Gideons, but they were supposed to have been delivering Bibles to Sonoma and high school and the middle school that's there. So I want to pray for them as they are in the midst of this. Next month, a month from now, we will have a Gideon's report. So we'll be able to find out what the Gideons have been doing in our county, in our area, and then also around the country and even around the world as we continue to serve and continue to encourage them and support them as we can. So we want to keep the Gideons in our prayers as well. More personally, we want to keep Dean Davis in our prayers. Dean is doing well. He is in the middle of his treatment that will be back in Tennessee for the next couple of months. And they have found a place. They're looking for another place to worship, but they were encouraged by where they went last Sunday. And we just want to pray for him. He has been just a real blessing and an encouragement to all of us being here with us. And so we want to pray for him and pray for the treatments that he's going through right now. And then also, if you would pray for Matt and Alyssa, they're the couple that would be married on Thursday, just for that to go as a very special day for them. They pray that it will be just a marvelous occasion of rejoicing and seeing God's faithfulness and seeing the demonstration of God's love that he gives to a man and a woman to be united in marriage. So we want to pray for that as well. There may be other things on your heart, other things of concern, other issues that you may need to be praying for. Maybe there's something in your life that you need to bring before the Lord this morning. Maybe there is something that is pressing upon your thoughts and your attitudes you need to be able to provide for. And did you have one?
Yeah, I was going to say, my brother-in-law, he's over 100 years old, and he's walking a little. Of course, he has to have his walker, but he's doing so great. And sometimes he wakes up in the morning and he's not together, but I say, come on, Rod, just be happy. It cheers up then.
All right. That's great. All right, so we will we'll be able to pray for him as well. His name is Roger, do you say, or is...
My brother-in-law.
Right, and his name is?
Rodney.
Rodney, okay. All right, well, we'll pray for Rodney as well today then. So,
thank you.
Okay, so let's go ahead and join together in prayer. And again, as we pray, we take a few moments to quietly pray, to seek the Lord, and then I will lead us in prayer after that time. So we'll take a few moments now together as God's people, and let's pray. O most holy and merciful Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name and the merits of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior, knowing that it is in and through him that we have an audience before you. We have the assurance that we can call you our Father, and that we know that your love extends to us, and it is an eternal love that never changes. We thank you that you are our Father and that you take care of us as a Father. We thank you for watching over us and granting unto us your provision, your care for each day that we have lived, for every moment that we are able to be here on this earth. And we rejoice in our salvation. We rejoice to know our sins are forgiven. We're grateful for your sending the Holy Spirit in our lives to empower us, enabling us to live a life that is pleasing before you. Not that we earn our salvation, but it is a joy of obedience and love to you for what you have done for us. And so this morning we lift our voices in prayer, our hearts in prayer together, as we seek after you for the things that are before us. We acknowledge that you are the sovereign one. We acknowledge that all things are under your control, from the littlest of things to worldwide consequences. We know your hand is there, and there are purposes that extend far beyond our ability to understand them. This morning, Lord, we come before you because you told us we could. And we come into your presence in prayer because you've invited us to. And with you here, we find fellowship. And we find a solace, a place of refuge, a comfort. And it is for that, O Lord, that we seek this morning. We thank you for your faithfulness to our church, for 14 years of ministry that is here, for all the history, Lord, that has moved us from place to place, from worshiping inside to worshiping outside to worshiping through Zoom. Lord, all of the various ways in which we have gone through these iterations of worship, and yet you have been faithful, and you have created faithfulness in your people. And for this, we praise you. And so we ask, O Lord, for your provision for what is ahead for us as we seek to serve you in ministry, as we obey you and your commands, as we love one another and proclaim the gospel in love to those around us. Lord, this morning we pray for the concerns we've mentioned. We pray for the family members of our church. We pray for Dean, that you would be with him and Linda. that you would watch over them and be with him in the treatment process he's going through. We thank you, Lord, for his life and testimony as a witness of the gospel of Christ, and pray that you would be merciful to him, allowing these treatments to bring about the healing that you bring, Lord, as he goes through this process. And then, Lord, we also want to pray for others of concern, those not with us today. Lord, we pray your hand of mercy and kindness to be upon them. And then, Lord, we pray for other situations around us. We pray for the Gideons and the ministry, Lord, for their faithfulness. We pray, O Lord, for Operation Christmas Child, that it would be a good year this year, that it would be productive, and that there would be many people responding, seeing the need of the hour to proclaim the gospel. And then, Lord, this morning I pray that you would be with Matt and Alyssa as they are making their preparations for their wedding on Thursday. We pray that you would make it a very special day for us of family and friends as we gather together to celebrate the love that you have given to each of them to be together as husband and wife. And may your blessings and your kindness and your grace and your love richly attend to them as they begin their marriage together. And then, Lord, we pray whatever the concerns that may be in our hearts this day, that you would hear our prayers. Whatever the concerns may be an issue of forgiveness, maybe just a thanksgiving, for you have done so much for us. And Lord, I pray that our hearts would overflow with thanksgiving as we see your faithfulness and work to us. Lord, grant us the joy of our salvation, for we know that you are the heart and the source of it. And bless us, O Lord, as we worship you this day. Be with each one here, that you would bless them and encourage them in their walk with you. Whatever the concerns may be, O Lord, we bring them before you. We bring them before you and pray that you would hear them and answer them in such a way that would bring to you great glory. And we pray for also, Lord, that you would be with Rodney today. Lord, may your hand be upon him. May you grant him rest and encouragement and strength. We thank you, O Lord, for his life, and just pray your blessings upon him as well. And so, Lord, we come before you with the concerns of our hearts, and we all lift them before you in the precious name of Jesus, as it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen.
I need no other, but you better.
Amen. We have been during this past month, looking at a series of sermons based on the solas of the Protestant Reformation. It's learning how we can really not just simply do history, although I love history, but also how we can fulfill the call of God to be faithful witnesses of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to honor Christ, trust Christ, love Christ. We might be more and more Bible-believing, Spirit-filled, Christ-honoring Christians, to exalt and to enjoy Jesus Christ, to be, in a sense, 21st century Protestant Reformation reformers, to carry on the heritage. And so we've been looking at these. We've looked already at Sola Scriptura, which could be the message of God's salvation, the Scriptures alone. Last week, we looked at Sola Gratia, which is the motivation for God's salvation. Why would God love me? Today, we're going to be looking at Sola Fide, which is the mode or the manner of receiving God's salvation. It is, in a sense, the instrument by which we obtain and understand what salvation is about. Then next week, we'll look at Solus Christus, the means of our salvation, Jesus Christ, and then end up on Reformation Sunday with Soli Deo Gloria, the majesty of God's salvation. So we're looking forward to this. So today we're going to look at Sola Fide, a Latin word that simply means faith alone. Now, faith, at its most fundamental basis of meaning, is simply this: trusting in someone or something with confidence. Trusting in something with confidence. And we do it all the time. I noticed today, this morning, as I watched you come in, every one of you exhibited great faith. You did that by sitting down in your chair. I don't think there was anybody that came in and looked at the chair and picked it up and examined it and said, I wonder if Pastor Kevin put this chair that's going to collapse when I sit on it. What is going to happen here? And so, no, you didn't look at it at all. You came right in and sat down. That's faith. We have faith that everybody, including those from England, are going to drive on the right side of the road. We have faith in little lights that turn red and green. We have faith all the time. So we're talking about faith. We're talking about putting trust in something. Now, in the Bible, we have a very clear definition of what this faith is, what biblical faith is. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 tells us, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for. The assurance of things hoped for. The conviction of things not yet seen. The assurance. The confidence. That's what biblical hope is. Elements of this biblical hope include knowledge. We have to know what we believe in. It includes assent, agreement that that is what we believe in. Then there is an element of trust. There is an element of obedience, which is acting on that faith. And then there is an element of perseverance with the steadfastness of faith, the qualities of faith. And at the heart of Sola Fide is the confidence that you are right before God, and that you have full access to all of His blessings, all of His promises, and His full righteousness. That is what faith is about. And we all want to stand someday when we stand before God. We all want to have that, standing before God and hear Him declare that we are righteous in His sight. We all, whatever people do in the world today, still have that in the back of their mind, doing those things which may make them right and good. From killing chickens, to bowing in Mecca, from resting on a bed of nails, to praying the rosary, from going to Sunday school, to saying the Lord's Prayer. We want to do what is right because we want to be right with God. That's our mentality. And so we have to answer, what is the answer to this great question? How can a person be right before God? You see, in the Reformation, this was Martin Luther's angst. This was his great dread, his great worry. How do you know you're right? Because we know our sins, and we know that we don't have a righteousness of our own. And so how is it that we can be right before God? That was his great dilemma, a great question that he dealt with. And this is for us as well, to make sure we're confident in this. What do you, and I wish we had a word, the verb form of believe. Believe is what we talk about. We have faith or we believe. The word in the Greek is the same word. And I wish we had a verb faith. If I could rewrite children's grammar book, I teach sixth grade grammar. That's my little, so I could teach, if I could change grammar, I would change the word believe to faith. Today I faith, yesterday I faithed, and tomorrow I will faith. Because that's the essence. We take believe as an intellectual thing. I believe it might rain today. I believe the sun will come out. I believe this or that. But it's more importantly that it is a faith. It is a trust. It is sitting in that chair with confidence that it will hold you up. And really, it comes down, in terms of our relationship before God, it comes down to two possibilities. Either you trust in what you do, or you trust in what God says. Either you are trusting in what you do, or what God says. And the problem with Luther was the church was teaching both. The church was saying faith is what we trust in God's word, but faith is also good works. And that was his struggle. And he battled with this with an unsettled spirit. One of his confessors, one of his professors, encouraged him, happened to be in Germany, said, you know, might be a good idea, Luther, to go make a pilgrimage to Rome. To get this idea of works, righteousness, all clear in your mind. To know that good works can make you right before God, which is what the church was teaching along with faith. Faith plus works. And so he went, and he must have seen quite a sight, because in that day in Rome, they boasted of having the following. They boasted that they actually had the rope which Judas hung himself with. They had a branch from the bush that blazed with the visible presence of God. They had the chains of Paul. And among all the other things they had was referred to as the Scalia Sancta, the staircase of Pilate that Jesus climbed up. It's still there today. 28 steps used to be built with wooden on the top of it. They took the wood off and they found just a few years ago that there even is now stone steps that have a little bit indentation in each step where people would go on their knees from step to step and they would push off with their feet from the previous step. So many people had done that, that had worn a groove on each step. And they believed that if you could do that and make a prayer at each step, that you would gain a great sense of righteousness by doing it. Your works could add to the righteousness. And so he did that. He ascended all 28 stairs. At the end, rather than shouting hallelujah, he looked on it and he said, what if this doesn't work? What if it doesn't work? What good of it? What have I really done? Have climbing up stairs made me more acceptable to God? What is the basis that makes us acceptable to God? What is it? Last week we talked about this amazing grace. What is it that makes this grace available to us? What is the channel? What is the means of doing that? And the problem is we get that so confused even in today, even our understanding today. And that's why I want to be really clear. I feel like I'm preaching to the choir. And I want to be very clear, though, however, to understand what this is really all about. Because we can have, if we do works, we can even get this sense of false security. We can have this whole thing figured out, and we works, and we can understand what goes on. I am toying with my seventh graders, because somebody the other day told me, Mr. Kirby, that when you give a pop quiz or a quiz, you always wear a blue shirt. They were trusting in that, right? So what do? I give them a quiz with a red shirt on. Sorry, guys, I know that. Yeah. But they were trusting in something and had a false security. We can trust in our works. We can trust that we can do things, and that actually provides a false security. Or even worse, it can be used as a way to control and manipulate people. You do want to go to heaven when you die, don't you? Well, then you've got to do this, this, and this. You do want God's righteousness, don't you? Well, then you've got to do this, this, and this. And usually somewhere along that this, this, and this comes out an offering box. That was the big thing in Martin Luther's day. In fact, the first slogan, the first advertisement came in that point, because they had little boxes, they called them coffers. And they would go from town to town because Pope wanted to build St. Peter's Basilica. And he didn't have enough money, but he convinced people to do this. And so their belief in purgatory, this kind of a nebulous land, because if you don't have full righteousness when you die, you don't go to heaven, you go through purgatory. But they had the opportunity. And so the little jingle, the little commercial was, when a coin in the coffer rings, a soul from purgatory springs. In essence, you pay money and you help somebody else get out of purgatory. Works righteousness. And that's how we come to, even in our day and age, to understand there is a works righteousness mentality. God has done this much, but I must do the rest. And that was Luther's great dilemma until he ran across Romans chapter 1. God led him to this. And it says, and it hit him like a thunderbolt. The righteous shall live by faith. What a transforming truth in a time when the darkness of that truth had come over it. This is the key of the reformers. This is what they brought back. Sola fide. And it's important that we understand what it means. We're talking about sola fide, not fide e labore, faith and works. And that's why the reformers, the big key for the reformers was simply sola, faith alone. Now, the churches resisted that doctrine because they were convinced it would lead to easy believism, which indeed it can. Just live, trust in Jesus and live any way you want to. And so they tried to infuse righteousness into people's lives by their good works. And so it comes down to this. Am I justified? Am I right before God because my works have made me righteous? Or am I right before God because the Bible declares that I am righteous? And I take that by faith. Sola fide, faith. It's the instrument that it's not the source of right of justification. It's the way it gets down to us. Just like when you turn on the computer, your computer does not produce the internet. Your computer is the means to bring the internet from wherever it lives into your house by means of a computer. So righteousness, your life does not produce righteousness, but there is an outside righteousness that has been declared to be yours. That's the foundation. That is sola fide. How are we to be right before God? The just shall live by faith. So I want to look at this. I want to we'll turn to the book of Romans. Early this week, I told Dean that we were going to be reading in Romans this week, and he rejoiced in that because he felt like we're going to Old Testament too much, so he was very happy to do this. So when you get this, Dean, we rejoice together with you as we go to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 3. We looked at that a little bit last week, but I want us to focus on this about faith. What do we mean when we say by faith alone? What are we declaring when we say by faith alone? How do you live out your life if you do believe indeed by faith alone? Because it's either faith alone or works. You can't have both. Either you're trying to get to heaven because you're doing all sorts of good deeds, or those good deeds are a result because you're already right before God, justified before Him. And that's what I want us to look at. So let's look chapter 3 of Romans, beginning with verse 21. We read the bad news last week in verses 19 and 20, so we're going to jump to the good news today. But now, the righteousness of God, that righteousness, that word means being right before God, that righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who, we can put that word faith in there again, who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Christ. This is Paul's description of sola fide. So what are you putting your trust in? On the day when you come before the Lord and stand before him and he says, on what basis are you welcomed into this place? What is your defense? What will you say? Will you give a list of all the things you've done? Will you give a list of all of the things you tried to serve him by? You try to say, oh, pastor, if only you would have known my spouse. If only you would have known my children. If only you would have known my parents. If only you would have known the job. If only you would have known all sorts of things. I did the best I could. And do I get a pass? Are you trusting in what you do? Or are you trusting in faith? And it's important to understand the kind of faith, because even the demons faith. And they tremble. They have a lot more reaction than a lot of Christians do, unfortunately. So what does it mean to be justified by faith alone? And that was the key word, alone. The church in the Reformation time said you can have faith in Christ plus your good works together will save you. But we believe it is faith alone that saves. So what does that mean? That means that we put a faith, that we have faith in three things. We have, first of all, we have a faith in a righteousness that is apart from our works. A righteousness that is apart from our works. We separate those things out. That's what Paul is doing in this letter to begin with. Because you see, first of all, there is the dilemma of sin. No matter how good you might be, no matter how perfect you might have lived your life, there's always going to be that issue of sin in your life. You're not going to have perfect righteousness. And you have to deal with that. Because you are required to produce full righteousness to be accepted by God. You want to know how to go to heaven? Very easy. Live a perfect life. But there isn't any that could do that. And that means full obedience to the law. That means you never disobey anybody. You never disobey parents. You never disobey teachers. You never disobey anything else. You never disobey God's commandments. You never disobey anywhere, everywhere for your entire life. Is anybody near that today? Not if they're honest. If they say yes, that's their first problem. That's their first sin. They lied. Because the Bible says you don't have the desire. You don't want to. You don't have to teach a child how to be rebellious. You don't want to. Nor do you have the ability to keep God's perfect law. Because even if you could, according to chapter 3, verse 20, the law was never designed to save. Let's go back to verse 20. For by the works of the law, that is your works, No human being will be justified in his sight. So if you're thinking or you're believing that you can do good works plus faith in Christ, you're on a fool's errand. And it's going down a dead-end street, and you're trusting that I'm going to be wearing a blue shirt and I'm going to be wearing a red shirt or a brown shirt. People who are trying to earn their way to heaven are trying to make it do something it can't. The design for the law was never to save. The design of the law was to show God's demands. Secondly, it was to point us to Christ. And third, it would be for gratitude. Works having already been justified. The only thing the law did was to condemn and to prove we can't do it. And therefore, Paul says in verse 23 of Romans chapter 3, which is the verse we see at every sports game. All right, everybody either holds up John 3:16 or Romans 3:23. Next ball game you look at, see if there's somebody in the stands holding up one of those two signs. What Paul says then, the conclusion is, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We're not glorifying him. This is the conclusion. No one has able to do this. So if you're placing your hope on that you can do enough to please God, then you don't have saving faith. What is your trust? What is your hope? What is your foundation? And the implications, according to James Boyce, is if this righteousness is apart from the law, then we can be saved right now, can't we? You don't have to wait till the end of your life and figure out all the good and all the bad and put them on the scales and see which way they go. You don't have to wait with doubt or fear or hesitation. We can know today. You can know right now with full assurance that you are justified before God. And I trust every single one of you have that. That's why I think I'm preaching to the choir this morning. But I want to make sure that we understand what is being talked about here. Secondly, is we know that salvation is certain. And third, in this way, God gets the glory. Because not only is there the dilemma of sin Paul is addressing here, but also the deliverance of God. Those two little words. But now, when we couldn't do anything, God could. And it's important for us to realize that we couldn't do anything, so we are sure to give God the glory for what he did on our behalf. If I think that God deserves all glory, why would I want to share that glory by saying it's my decision? Instead, if there's a way to give God full glory, then he deserves all full glory. And if I believe, as the Bible teaches, that I am in a helpless state in my sinful condition and needing salvation, and he has done it all for me, as we read earlier in Romans 5, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, then I want him to get the full glory. And that's the deliverance that comes from God. When we were helpless, God acted. This is the good news that we have. This is the good news of the Reformation. This is the justifying gospel. And what does it mean to be justified? It means that we've been pardoned. It means we've been established. And we use that word. That's another word we use all the time, right? We use that in computers. Left justified, right justified, sinner justified. What do we do when we justify something? That means we line up everything in a straight line, a perfect line, on one side or the other side. We've been justified. We've been lined up perfectly by God's demands. That's what God has done for us. He has delivered us. It is nothing that we can do, but it is a declaration from God that we stand righteous and acceptable before him. Isn't that great? That we stand right before God. That's my faith. I can't explain. I can't show you how it works. But I have put my life in that statement. And when I get before God, as I've told you, on the day that I die, you can be assured as I stand before God, that my only defense, my only justification for being in heaven is not going to say, well, you know, I pastored for a lot of years in Petaluma. And Lord, you know the kind of church I pastored. You know, they were sweet, good people, but most of the time. But I'm not going to say any of that. What I'm going to say is, God, you have given to me a righteousness, and I stand in that righteousness. And so that's the first thing we want to understand. What it means by faith alone, we're talking about a righteousness by faith alone. We're talking about a righteousness that is apart from anything that we've done. Now, the second thing it is how did that happen then? Did God look the other way? Did God minimize the standards? Did God do away with the standards and love and says, I just want to love everybody? So I'm just going to justify you. No. The second great truth of this righteousness that we faith in is a righteousness that was accomplished by Christ. That's the second standard. That's the second great truth of the sola fide. Because somebody had to die for your sins. Somebody had to pay your price. And if we can't and didn't, then somebody had to. Referred to in some theological circles as an alien righteousness. Doesn't mean it was made by aliens. It means it was outside of our effort. Something totally, completely outside of us took care of it. One time only, I remember one time I was driving across the bridge, and just to see the reaction, I paid for the person. That's when you paid with that. Remember those people actually sat in those booths? I may be really aging myself at this point, but they used to have people sitting in the booth taking your money as you drove by. I paid for the guy behind me and just watched his reaction. You could just see him in the rearview mirror. I was just watching a little conversation going back and forth. And even as I was pulling away, I could just see the bewilderment in his eyes. And then apparently he got it because he sped up and got next to me and then waved. He didn't have to pay, not because there was no charge. It was because somebody else paid his toll. You see what we're getting at? You're not free. You're not justified because somebody has released the requirements for justification. Instead, somebody else paid that price. And that price was death. And that's what Paul is talking about here. For the righteousness of verse 22, for the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ. And he talks about through in verse 24, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Verse 25, Jesus being their propitiation, that by his blood we have received grace, justification by faith. The redemption is by Christ. A righteousness accomplished by Christ, a redemption by Christ. Jesus Christ purchased out from our sin with his own life. You ever stop and think about that? He did two things. He lived a perfect life and gave that to us, but he also took care of our sin problem, which meant he had to die for us. And that Jesus' death satisfied all of the righteous and holy demands of God. And that God the Father gave his Son as a sacrifice of atonement for a satisfaction of the holiness of God. Amazing. Your sin was so despicable and so hideous and so offensive to God that the only way to resolve it is by a death. And yet his love is amazing that he sent his son to do it and that Jesus willingly took our place. I hope that never becomes boring to you. I hope that never becomes mundane, that Jesus died on the cross for your sins. Three terms that were used here, because the merit of grace is based on Jesus Christ. And do you see why, if you add your works to it, how offensive that really is? How ungodly that really is? It ceases to be grace. And what it becomes are wages that are earned. I did the work, I get the money for it. But sola fide states that I did the crime and Jesus paid the punishment. Three terms he uses. He refers to it as justification, which is a legal term, which to justify means to declare not guilty. We've all seen court cases where everybody in the room knows the guy is guilty, and yet there's some kind of a technicality. Maybe he wasn't read his Miranda rights, or maybe they got the information in the wrong way, or who knows what it is. Because of that, the judge has to declare what? Not guilty. And the guy gets away. We hate that when it happens like that. We want justice. But the man has been justified by a technicality. We've been justified by a Savior, not a technicality. Justification, one theologian writes, is an instantaneous legal act of God in which he thinks and considers all of our sins as forgiven and Christ's righteousness as belonging to us. That's why Romans 8:1 says, there is now therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Justified. You're justified. When God sees you, he does not see your sin. He sees the blood of Jesus Christ that has covered that sin. And the reason why God will never change his disposition for you is because Jesus Christ never changes. The blood never gets old. The blood never expires. Now we say, well, okay, if the more I sin, the more grace I get, then maybe I should live a life of sin to get all this kind of grace. No, that's Paul says, no. You got the right theology, but the wrong conclusion. And that's later on in the book of Romans. We probably won't get there. But you're justified. Do you live that way? Do you live justified? Or do you still carry upon you the weight and the burden and the guilt and the shame and of the sin that you have committed sometimes years and years ago? We've been justified. We stand before God completely justified. That's the first term. Second term we see about the redemption of Christ is the word redemption itself, the buyback, the payback. It means to go and redeem something from the marketplace. You remember the book of Hosea in the Old Testament. Hosea had a wife whose name was Gomer. I want to say Gomer or something because Gomer doesn't sound like, you know. I'm sure she was prettier than her name sounds. She had a couple of children with him, and then she had children without him, according to what the Bible is. And she wound up being in the slave market. And Hosea is about to say, I told you so, God. You know what she deserves. And what did God say? Go get her. Buy her back. And you see that picture in the Old Testament where there's an auction going on. So much money and a bushel of hay, you know, a bushel of whatever. He finally won her. Now, that was probably the last person in the world she wanted to be redeemed by. I'm sure the wait on the trip home was not one of those wonderful, magical moments that Disney would produce. But he bought her back. When we were enslaved, he redeemed us. When we were enslaved by our own sin, the picture is that Jesus redeemed us. He went to the marketplace and he purchased us. He paid the price for our freedom. That's the second term. The third term we see here is the word propitiation. That's a great word that nobody uses. It's in the Bible a number of times. Some people can't even pronounce it. But what that means is a sacrifice of atonement to appease an angry God. And that's what we have here. We have a propitiation by his blood. Jesus is our justifier, our redeemer, and our propitiation. The redemption by Christ. And then we see this accomplished by Christ. So what do we do? How do we get that? How does that become reality in our life? What is the basis for me to say I've been forgiven? My sins have been cleansed. I stand before God. If I say, let me work for it, do you see how it tears it all apart? And so this redemption by Christ is be received by faith. I receive it by faith. He gives us this as a gift, and faith even itself is a gift. Ephesians 2, 8, 9, for by grace you've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. That faith is not of yourselves. It is a gift of God. That faith, the ability to believe, a gift of God, the ability to trust, the ability of God. We receive it by faith. We have this gift by faith. We're all sinners, and we must trust in what Jesus has done on the cross of Calvary. By trusting in his death, his burial, and his resurrection, because that's the essence of this, Jesus says, you want to know how it's all going to be true? Find out 3 days from my crucifixion. Find out where I'm going to be 3 days later. Because if I'm raised from the dead, everything that I've ever said is true. If not, as Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, they were Jehovah false witnesses. So we receive it by faith. We receive it as a gift. Did you earn it? No. Do you deserve it? No. Is it yours? Yes. How does that work? Faith. By faith. I'm taking God's word for it. I don't have anything to prove to God to make it worthy of me. I can't prove to you that I'm worthy of that. In fact, I could probably prove to you I'm not worthy of that. But if God says this, that Jesus died for my sins and that he was raised for my justification, then I believe it. I faith it. I take it as my reality. You say, well, that could be a false reality, couldn't it? Well, if I was trusting in something else, it might be. But I'm trusting in the Word of God. I'm trusting in the confirmed, true Word of God to tell me what my condition is. And so I faith, and so my faith declares that there is a righteousness accomplished by Christ. That's the second thing. Third thing we're going to look at, and then we'll wrap up here. Third thing is sola fide speaks of a righteousness that is acquired as a gift. Did you ever get a great gift for somebody else? You spent time, you've looked at the right gift, and you just know this is the perfect gift. Every once in a while we do that, right? And you wrap it perfectly, and you give it to this person, and you watch them, and they open the gift, and they're amazed at this gift. They're remarkable. And then what do? Then they take out their wallet and say, how much do I owe you? What do I owe you for this gift? Wouldn't that be a little insulting? That's what works does. Because how we gain this righteousness, how we access this, is as a gift. It is by God's grace. Ephesians says, "For by grace you are saved through faith. That not of yourselves." Even the faith is a gift of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That's the means. That's the manner. That's the computer that we turn on that receives the internet. Faith accesses God's righteousness. Why would we want to add anything to it? And yet so many people do. They figure if they do enough good works, they're going to get saved. Or they combine the two, as Luther struggled with in his earlier days. But it's a gift. We depend utterly and totally on God, even for the granting of saving faith, because we can't even muster faith on our own. It's all a gift from God. It would be like going to a cemetery, as I said last week, going to a cemetery with a great meal. You've cooked a fine, great meal. You go to a cemetery, and you put it on a stone somewhere. You say, "Okay, everybody, all you have to do is just get up from your grave, and I've got a great meal for you here." And then wait to see what's going to happen. Not a thing. That's what works does. That's what trying to earn God's salvation does. Because we're dead. God makes us alive. And we respond in faith. It is required as a gift. Notice he says that. He talks about back up in verse 24. "For we are justified by his grace as a gift." God delighted to give you that gift. It is his to give. And we rejoice in that. Second part of this, acquired as a gift. It is by God's grace. And ultimately, he says, in verse 26, why did God do this? In verse 25 and 26, why even God do this? Which is the second part of this. It is by God's grace. It is for God's glory. Why did God do this? Why would God care about me? A sinner, condemned already on death row, completely justified in my sin, declared guilty, just waiting for the death penalty. Why would he care about me? Why would the great God of glory have anything to do about me? It was to show his righteousness, his glory. That is something I think for eternity the angels are going to be scratching their head. They don't get salvation. These glorious beings, if they sin, there's no mercy for them. And they're going to be standing there thinking, "Why did you bypass us? Do you see what you just saved? Do you see this mess that's there? And you love that mess? And you redeemed that mess, and you've made him like you so that he will share, he or she will share in glory forever to be like Christ. You did that for his glory." Like I told you earlier, and I'm using up all my old stories, so you have to bear with me here, that when my dad was working for Sears, he worked in the tool department, and Sears had a policy that if a tool was broken, you could always bring it back. And they would give you a new tool. Do you ever know where the old tools went? They went to the employees. My dad had a toolbox full of these things. And yet he had the ability to make some pretty amazing things with them. And I would always be amazed. And I said, wow, you made that with this? I didn't say what amazing tools. I said, what an amazing carpenter. When we are prepared for glory, they're not going to say, what an amazing vessel of glory. They're going to say, what an amazing God that you would take a fallen sinner and declare him righteous, him or her righteous, and bring him eternity with you. That is what he did. We can't reason that out. We can't figure out the mind of God into why that would be the way it was. No more, no less than we receive it. How? By faith. It was to show, he says in verse 26, his glory, his righteousness, his consistency, his word. It was to show his righteousness that at the present time, so that he might be just and justifier. Just and justifier. Having Christ die for the sins of sinners makes him just, because sin hasn't paid for, and the justifier, the one who redeems. And the justifier of who? Of the one who has what? Faith in Christ. If you are trusting in Christ alone for your salvation, if you are trusting sola fide, the Bible tells us that we will be the ones who will experience the just and the justice and the justifier of a great God. A new relationship, a new life, a new presence, a new glory for Christ. Poet, a hymn writer by the name of William Cowper, had an early Christian life, and yet during the course of time, fell away from what he thought was his life and went into all sorts of sin and went all sorts of misery and all sorts of struggles in his life and lived a horribly wicked, sinful life. And as a result, he was deeply concerned and lived regularly under the fear of God's wrath. The story goes, one day he flung himself into a chair by a window and saw a Bible that was sitting there. And he wrote this. I opened it up, he wrote, and my eyes fell on Romans 3:25, which says of Christ, whom God has made a propitiation through faith in his blood. Then and there I realized what Christ's blood had accomplished, and I realized the effects of his atonement for me. And then and there, I trusted Jesus Christ, and a great burden was lifted from my soul. Looking back on that day, years later, he wrote a hymn with these words. There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. From beginning to end, the work of Christ, and we receive it sola fide. Let's pray. Lord, we are truly amazed at the depth of your love and your salvation for us. We humbly, graciously, even joyfully confess that there is nothing in us that was ever worthy of your doing what you did for us. We could not attain a level of acceptance before you on our own effort. But in your great grace and by your mercy, you provided the way for us. And that way is through your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord. And it's beyond us. It's outside of us. It's not our works, but His work. It's not our effort, but His effort. And yet it is our result. It is our justification. It is our salvation. Lord, may we always trust. May we always faith in You and not in our efforts. Lord, there may be people here this morning that maybe understand that, but they're still trying to live their life out by their works. But Lord, maybe there's still a performance based on they do more, You love them more. They do less, You love them less. I pray, Lord, that You would help them to see that as a residual thinking of works. That our confidence, our assurance, and our hope may be only in You by faith. And may this be the heart of our message, of our lives, and our relationship with You, through Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And let's stand as we sing our closing hymn for today.
Encamped along the hills of light, ye Christian soldiers rise and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the foe in veils below, let all our strength be hurled. It is the victory we know that overcomes the world. Faith is the victory.
Lord, as we leave from here now, we pray that faith will be ours through Jesus Christ, that will grant unto us great victory in Your name, that You would receive the praise and the glory. For this we ask in His name. Amen.
Amen.